children, welcome back. Today we will learn geography chapter 3, humidity and cloud. What is the meaning of humidity? Humidity means it's a concentration of water vapor present in the air. And the meaning of cloud is a visible mass of condensed watery vapor floating in the atmosphere, typically high above the general level of the ground. Observe the figure shown in the video. See all the three pictures. The first picture is about weather condition, dry and hot place Rajasthan, Thar. Second picture tells us weather condition, cold and dry place Kashmir, Himalayan mountain. Third, weather condition, hot and humid place coastal city, Mumbai. We experience the dampness or dryness. Dampness means the moisture which you have seen on the walls of your houses, the wet like thing, or dryness in the air throughout the year. The changes occurring in the weather condition in desert area, coastal areas and mountainous areas is evident means visible from the figures. Rajasthan lies in a region with dry and hot air. There is hardly any moisture in the air. People wear loose cotton clothes in Rajasthan. Kashmir Valley lies in a region cold and dry air. Moisture is minimum in the air. People cover themselves with warm clothes, as it is very cold there. In the Mumbai, the air is hot and humid. There is the proportion of moisture is very high in the air. And that's why, see, most of the time we feel hot as we are a Mumbaikar. In addition, if dark clouds cover the sky, the content of moisture in the air increases. In the above discussion, the word hot, moist, cold, etc. show the condition of the air. They relate to the content of the moisture in the air. Moisture in the air is invisible, but it is the major component of air which is taken into consideration while discussing the weather of any place. Precipitation. Precipitation means rain, snowfall, to condensation on the ground. For precipitation to occur any place, presence of moisture in the air is very important. Think about it. During winter, when you exhale on the glass of your mirror, what happens? If you do this in summer, why doesn't this happen? Have you noticed? Winter, the moisture holding capacity of air is low due to low temperature. Therefore, when we exhale on the glass on the mirror, the condensation means droplets of water present in the exhaled air takes place, as it affect very thin water droplets are found on the glass of the mirror. Because of the sun's heat, the water on the earth gets converted into water vapor. The process of evaporation is dependent on dryness, temperature, and the speed of the wind. If the air is dry and hot, the rate of evaporation increases. The process of evaporation continues even in the dry and cold air. On the other hand, evaporation occurs very slowly in the moist air. If the velocity and temperature of the air is high, then evaporation occurs rapidly. If a wind is blowing slowly and air is cooler, the evaporation occurs slowly. The proportion of water vapor in the air is called its humidity. The dryness and the dampness of the air depends upon the proportion of water vapor. Air can hold moisture in specific quantity at specific temperature only. As air cools down, its moisture holding capacity reduces. Warmer air can hold more moisture than the cold air. At a certain temperature, the moisture holding capacity of air becomes equal to proportion of moisture present in it. Is called saturation of the air. Try this activity. Take a colander tray which is deeper in the center. Take a piece of sponge on the flat part of the tray. Make holes with the help of nails. Keep the sponge on the center of the tray. Make sure there is no water in the sponge. Pour water on the sponge with a big spoon. Now note how many spoons of water have been poured. Keep pouring water with the spoon till the sponge becomes wet with water. Note what happens if you keep pouring water even after that. Now answer the questions. What do you observe? First question, what happens to the water which was poured initially? Answer, the water which was poured initially was absorbed in the sponge. So you can see there is no water down. Second question, when you were pouring water on the sponge, what did you expect? Answer, we expect that water will trickle out from the sponge. Trickle means come out. Falls out. Third, what happened when you pour more water on the sponge? Answer, water trickles out from the sponge. The water comes out from the sponge. Fourth, what conclusion can you draw from this? Answer, after certain limit, the water holding capacity of the sponge comes to an end. If we pour more and more water, the water comes out. Let's suppose that the air is like a piece of sponge. How many spoons of water does the sponge absorb? After the sponge is full of water, drops of water started trickling out. One can tell the number of spoons of water required to make the water trickle down the sponge by observation. This implies that the water holding capacity of the sponge is fulfilled, and that's why this make it fully filled, and that's why the water was coming out from the sponge. Similarly, when the proportion moisture in the air exceeds its water holding capacity, precipitation in the form of snow or rain occurs on the earth. The moisture holding capacity of the air depends upon its temperature. Higher the temperature, higher is the holding capacity. We have learned earlier that as we go higher in the sky, the air becomes cooler. So as per this, as we go higher, the vapor holding capacity of the air will decrease. Always remember, generally humidity of the air is measured in gram per cubic meter. When the humidity in the air is 0 gram per cubic meter, the air is said to be dry. If the humidity in the air at 30 degree temperature is 37 gram per cubic meter, then the air is said to be saturated. We'll study about types of humidity. Humidity is divided into 3 types: absolute, relative, and specific. First, we will study about absolute humidity. the amount of water vapor in 1 cubic meter of air is the absolute humidity of the air. Example, the absolute humidity of the air near coastal area is higher than the air in the interior. Absolute humidity is higher equatorial areas, while it reduces as we move towards the pole. The distribution of land and water on the earth and the season also affect the absolute humidity. Relative humidity. The amount of water vapor present in air can be expressed as a percentage of the amount needed for saturation at the same temperature and same volume. It is expressed in percentage. For relative humidity is, relative humidity equals to absolute humidity upon vapor holding capacity into 100. Amount of water vapor changes according to the difference in temperature. Similarly, relative humidity also changes. Generally, relative humidity is more in the morning and night. In the afternoon, as temperature increases, relative humidity decreases. Near coastal areas, the relative humidity is more and so the air is moist. But in desert area, relative humidity is less. Try this. Take water in a pressure cooker. Take off the whistle of the pressure cooker. Now heat the cooker. Take a lid with a handle. After the water starts boiling, hold the lid at a distance from the vessel. Steam is coming out. Observe what happens. You must have observed that water changed into water vapor when it is heated. This vapor turns into water droplets when it is touched over the lid. We can see the water droplets deposited on the lid. Next activity. Take a glass with flat bottom. Put some ice cubes in it. Keep this glass in a room for 2 to 3 minutes. What did you see? In some times you see droplets of water on the outer surface of the glass. When the water vapor in the air comes in contact with the cooler surface, condensation takes place. These droplets form on the outer surface of the glass. In the first activity, the steam from the cooker cooled and condensed and formed the water droplets. In the second activity, the vapor in the air condensed, the cooler droplets are formed. Condensation, desiccation, and sublimation. The process of changing of water vapor in the air is called condensation or desiccation. Also, the process of vapor changing into solid state is called sublimation. If the temperature of the air reduces, its vapor holding capacity also reduces. When relative humidity of the air becomes 100%, vapor condensing. At this time, the temperature of the air should be condensation, densification, and sublimation. The process of changing of water vapor in the air into water is called condensation or densification. Also, the process of vapors changing into solid state is called sublimation. If the temperature of the air reduces, its vapor holding capacity also reduces. When relative humidity of the air becomes 100%, vapor starts condensing. At this time, the temperature of the air should be at dew point. It implies that for condensation, temperature should be below and relative humidity must be high. In the free environment, condensation of the vapor in the air occurs around fine particles like dust, salt, etc. in the air. Dew, frost, and fog are the forms of condensation at ground level, while clouds are a form of condensation at higher elevation. Next, we'll study clouds and types of clouds. Clouds are a form of condensation at higher elevation. Condensation occurs around minute particles in the atmosphere. Condensed water or snow particles in the clouds are very fine and almost weightless, and so clouds float in the air. Lands and water get heated because of the heat of the sun. Air near the surface heat uprises and becomes less dense. Hot air rises up. As it goes higher, the temperature of the air reduces and the moisture holding capacity of the air reduces. Relative humidity keeps increasing. The water vapor in the atmosphere turns into water and snow. This is the dew point level of the air. The level of condensation is determined by the water vapor in the air. Keep in mind that the freezing point is also depend on the altitude and water vapor. Because of condensation, fine particles of ice and water float in the air at a greater height. They accumulate, get settles, that means, around dust particles in the air and become large in size. The accumulation together is called a cloud. Because of vertical flow of the wind, they float in the atmosphere. Like a kite which floats in the air as it moves higher and higher. The clouds too float in the atmosphere because of vertical flow. Clouds are found at different altitudes. Above means sea level. Clouds which form at greater altitude are formed from very fine snow particles. The process of evaporation and condensation occurs consecutively in the clouds. Specific type of cloud cause rainfall on Earth. The proportion of vapor is more near the Earth's surface. As we go higher away from the sea level, the amount of vapor decreases. Hence, the cloud at a lower altitude are larger in size, while the clouds at higher altitude are smaller. Clouds are formed at different altitudes in the atmosphere. After observation, we can divide these clouds into three main types on the basis of their altitude. The height from the base of the cloud is taken into consideration. If the cloud are at an altitude of 7,000 to 14,000 meter, then they are considered as very high clouds. If they are at an altitude of around 2,000 to 7,000 meter, then they are considered to be medium clouds. If they are at an altitude of less than 2,000 meter, then they are low clouds.
Clouds. These clouds are mainly made up of ice particles. They can be classified into cirrus, cirrocumulus and cirrostratus. Cirrus clouds are mainly wispy. Cirrocumulus clouds look like group of small waves. Cirrostratus are like a bed sheet with wrinkles. They generally have a halo around them. Next is medium clouds. These clouds include altocumulus and altostratus. Altocumulus are in the form of layers and have a wave-like structure. They are mostly white in color and have a gray shade. Altostratus are not very thick. The sun can be seen through them as if seen through a milky glass. Now we'll move on to low clouds. These clouds consist of five type of clouds. Stratocumulus have layers. Their color is white to earthy, like a earth color, brown. Round cluster of clouds can be here. Stratus cloud also have layers. They are ash colored and their base is uniform. Nimbostratus has thick layers. They are grayish in color and cause continuous rainfall and even snowfall.
Cumulus clouds. These clouds are formed extensively from 500 meter to 6000 meter altitude. The vertical flow of the air adds to the formation of these clouds. They are huge and dome shaped. They are gray in color. Cumulus clouds are an indicator of pleasant weather. The vertical expanse of these clouds increases so much that they turn into cumulonimbus clouds and bring rain.
Next, we'll study cumulonimbus clouds. These are characteristic clouds which are indicators of thunderstorm. These look like huge mountains. These are dense and dark in color. There is thunder accompanied by lightning. They bring rain with storm and may sometime bring hailstone, but such a type of rain does not last long. The largest of these clouds bring rainfall accompanied with lightning. The top portion of these clouds have an anvil like shape. See, it's shown in the picture. These clouds have a positive charge at the upper end and negative charge at the lower end. The end below them always has negative charge. Due to difference in the charges, electric charges are formed and lightning occurs, lighting up the sky for a moment. The air around the lightning rises up because of the heat, and this led to a large thundering sound. As compared to other clouds, the rain drops of these clouds are larger because they move up and down a lot of time and accumulate more and more water. Drops become larger and larger and are unable to float in the clouds because of their weight. They fall in the form of rain. Sometimes the air in the clouds is very cold. As a result, these drops freeze and fall in the form of hail. We call them hailstones.
For your assignment, write the exercise from your textbook, page number 23. The answers are given in the further video.